I, before I, oh, I am wired up. I thought that to start things off, I would like to talk about when you make something, there's got to be lots of reasons behind it, and there's got to be lots of history behind it. And since music has been my whole world, I thought it might be interesting. Let me just click on a few things and make sure they're working. Okay, they are working. Let's really do that. Before I do this, I want to say one thing really that was not, I'm not a speech maker. I'm a talker. So I have this problem. I've been a teacher all my life. And I have this problem of, I just love to talk about stuff. And that's really what I'd like to do today. But one of the talking about stuff things is that when this World's Fair was built, the same month, June 1964, is when Bob Moog and I built the first Moog synthesizer. It was June 1964. At the same time, the woman who was going to be my wife, and is my wife, was singing at the World's Fair. So we have this like interesting thing, and I shouldn't say this really, but I can't not say it. You have to look at me and believe it. I actually went to the 1939 World's Fair. And the only thing I can remember, I don't want to tell you how big I was, but I was very little. I was a little kid. And the only thing I remember about the World's Fair is I went up to some machine that could imitate your voice and say words, and I said, anti-disestablishmentarianism, which was the biggest word I ever heard in my life, and I think my brother or somebody taught it to me. Anyway, I want to get into a little bit of stuff here, and I think it might be of interest. So let me just talk a little bit about the world that was around in the 1950s before we built a synthesizer. And I wanted to read something, and that is something, it'll balance very nicely with whatever you hear. And I'm not sure when you'll hear stuff, but that's okay. This was written in 1937 by a guy named John Cage. Now, if you're interested, he was really one of the beginners of the whole world of question tonality. Question the whole idea of what we think of as music. There's a whole different way. In 1937, wherever we are, it's mostly noise. When we ignore it, it disturbs us. When we listen to it, we find it fascinating. The sound of a truck at 50 miles an hour, static between the stations. We want to capture and control these sounds, to use them not as sound effects, but as musical instruments. Every film studio has a library of sound effects. We call it on film. With a film phonograph, it's now possible to control the amplitude and frequency of any of those sounds and to give it rhythms within or beyond the reach of the imagination. Given four film photographs, we could compose and perform a quartet for electronic, motor, wind, heartbeat, landslides. Now this is, I just wanted to include this. I'm been a teacher a long time, but and I don't like, I'm not trying to get up and say, like, that I think this is just a big part of why we decided to make an instrument. Bob Moog had been a big fan of, well, the idea of pheromones. When I met Bob Moog, I had built an old phone. He saved me his kit. And I built this kit in 1961 or 2. I hadn't met him. I had no idea who he was. And like most people in the world, I figured his name was Moog. But, you know, and so but I called up and I got his wife on the phone. And she, the first thing she did was say, no, it is not. So, yeah, I got this kit. And I said, it's great, I'm going to make. And you didn't really hear them that much, although the theremin was actually invented, believe it or not, in 1920 by a Russian whose name was Theremin. He named it after himself. Interesting thing, that's another whole story. But because it was the beginning of the 20th century, the fact that Theremin really came up with this imagination idea in 1920, the Soviet Union had just been formed 3 years earlier. And so Theremin actually, who was just a young, brilliant engineer and musician, got his way to see Lenin, who was the head of the whole Soviet Union. I don't know how he got to see him, but he did. And he taught Lenin how to play a tune on a theremin. But that's a story that you don't read in many books. And because of that, the Russians gave him anything. Build the instrument, we'll get you overseas, we'll get you concerts, we'll get you a wonderful girlfriend when she was only about 18. And they stayed together for a little while, but then when Theremin came to the United States, he sold the United States on the idea of giving him everything. And he got involved with a company called RCA, which is now NBC. And they built a big theremin in about 1930 that they tried to sell, making it, they tried to tell everybody it's the easiest instrument in the world to play because you don't have to touch it. And it didn't do very well. They didn't sell very many because when people found a theremin, they realized that it's the hardest instrument in the world to play, not the easiest. And you know what? Let me just kick on something here. Thank you. Okay. It's time to change clothes. I hope I don't change too many clothes. But I'll change this one. I think I'm still wired up. Okay. I'll get rid of the next one. Okay. I just wanted to tell you, I was getting a little bit less sound out of the instrument. So I know you're up there and you guys can all hear me talk, right? So okay, so the sound's working fine. Thank you. Thanks, guys. I just didn't want to overblow stuff. Yeah, it seemed like the gain is up too high.
Yeah, you're way
blessed. Yeah, that's what I was concerned about, because I had the gain up. Let me just put up the basic gain on the instruments. Okay. All right. Okay. Thank you. Thanks. And now the time that I met Bob, he had already been selling these, but I did. There was no synthesizer, and I met him. Actually, I am from New York State, and I teach in a school in New York, actually on Long Island, and I'll even give it a plug. It's Hofstra University, and I went up to a New York State School Music Association event, which was right at the beginning of my teaching year. It was 1963. And I wanted to see what was going on. I had just started teaching, and I wanted to see a little bit about what kids were doing. So I went to this New York State has this music group called NISMA, and I went to their all-state conference, and people sell things there, you know, the little rooms where they sell stuff. And I walked into this little room, and there was this man selling nothing but theremins and tubas in one room. Just think about this, theremins and tubas. Well, it turns out the guy selling theremins was Bob Moog. There was nobody there selling the tubas, but the guy who designed the tubas, actually, I remember his name. His name was Walter Sear. And he was doing like business work, helping Bob Moog sell theremins. And he was a tuba designer and a tuba player and a really good musician. And he went in, if anybody knows a little bit, I'll mention his name, because he went into recording and became a really important recording engineer in New York City. He recorded loads of great rock bands. So that's enough, you know, but he was, for a brief time working with Moog. Moog did not have a real company. At that point, he was operating out of his house in Ithaca, New York. And I was talking to him, and nobody came in. So it was great. I was just me talking to Bob Moog. And we talked, and I said, "Well, that theremin, it's a great instrument. How is it? Have you seen people using an electronic music?" And Bob said, "Well, I really don't know enough. I don't know anything about electronic music. I heard of the term, but I don't know anybody who's doing it." I said, "Bob, with your skill and your knowledge, we should get together and build some kind of a music synthesizer." The term synthesizer was used by believe it or not, RCA again. And they built, well, it wasn't an instrument. What they did was they put dozens and dozens of pieces of equipment in a wall in a room at Columbia University. And they called it the RCA synthesizer. And it was not an instrument. It was like dozens of instruments. And Moog said, well, you know, what do you mean? I said, well, that's, you know, what about the idea of putting together something that people could actually buy and have in their homes? And, you know, it could, you know, be sold to composers. They would be interested in it. And I had a concert going on that January in New York. And the concert went on the 10th or 11th of January, 1964. And Bob went to the concert. And after the concert, the concert was held in Greenwich Village. If you're from New York, you know we wanted to go out to eat. What kind of food did we eat if we were in Greenwich Village? We ate Italian food, because that's where all the restaurants are. Anyway, so he and his wife and me and my wife sat down and we talked and we decided, let's build a synthesizer. And literally talked about it in the beginning of 1964. About a month later, we were, you know, just writing each other letters and making phone calls in the old days of telephones, where you turn things. And where you actually dial a telephone. And we talked about it, and I said, well, you know, my school maybe could really help you. Why don't you write me a real letter? He wrote me a formal letter saying, let's get together this summer and work on the idea of building a new musical instrument. So I presented that to my university, and they approved it. They said, this is a very good idea. Do I have the nerve to do this? I will. If I have it here in front of me. If not, I'll just tell you the story. It's just funny to read it from the university, standpoint. Okay, yeah, he wrote me a letter. See, he said, in this letter, I want to formally invite you to visit this summer to experiment and compose at length. So this was Bob writing to me. The university wrote back, and they said, you just have to appreciate it. I should have done these as projections. But I told you I like to talk. Here it is. This is the official letter from Hofstra University. Dear Mr. Herbert Deutsch, upon the recommendation of the Dean of Faculty, with the endorsement of the Executive Committee, you have been awarded a study grant in the amount of $200. That's the money that Hofstra gave me to design a new synthesizer in the year 1964. I didn't get rich. And the funny thing is, I've never really gotten rich from a synthesizer. I just love where it went, and you know, it's been so exciting to be part of that whole world. And I threw this all on top of stuff that I'm going to play. Let me see if we...
Mr. Deutsch, sir.
You are listening to history.
Greetings to all of you.
This is real
from
history.
Me and the rest of us. Before I begin to show you the modular components that I'm going to send you, Herb, I thought I'd play a little bit on the Abominatron here.
The Abominatron.
Doesn't sound like much when I play it. Maybe with someone with more musicianship and imagination can get some good things out of it. I tuned up all the oscillators quickly and I didn't worry about tone quality or balance between the various parts of the manual. Also, the keying is clicky.
There's a couple of
unfortunately, this is a problem I didn't worry about. I can solve it, but it's going to take a few more sets of contact, which I don't have right now.
He sent me a tape.
Okay.
A 7-inch tape.
The first tone quality you'll hear is just a triangular wave, unmodulated. And this way it sounds just like a cheap little organ. Probably the biggest advantage is that you can slide the entire keyboard up and down and all the notes will stay relatively in tune. I'll just slide it up and down with a potentiometer. You can hear the effect. Of course, you can modulate the frequency with any of the signals that can be produced. I'll just illustrate a couple. Most obvious one, of course, is sticking a little sine or triangular wave, low frequency, and get a vibrato. Here's sawtooth modulation. Here's square wave modulation.
Here.
It sounds to me like these broad modulation effects are only useful when you play one note at a time, in which case it's no use having a polyphonic instrument with
so that's why
wide modulation.
Built the very first synthesizer.
The keyboard sliding might be useful, especially if you can slide while you're playing with the foot pedals.
Because he had trouble hearing the complexity.
Well, I'd appreciate your comments. What you think of the potential of a contraption like this is. And if you do happen to think of a short biddy that you can write for it, I'd be glad to see it and try it out, do the best I can with it. It's 2 days later now, Herb, and I've talked to you since I made the recording on the polyphonic keyboard.
Well, he said it would be nice if you could write a nice short biddy. That was in 1964. In the fall of 1964, I wrote a little short biddy. I'm going to only play a little of it because it's not that short. But it's a piece that I wrote at that time. I wrote it in about September of 1964. I'm not going to play it because I'm going to play it from my CD. because in order to play it, you need a grand piano and a trumpet. Because I also play trumpet. But I had to play a grand piano because it has to be opened up so that you can reach inside and use timpani sticks to play rolls on the low sections of the piano and reach inside and pluck strings to get the sounds of the piano to match the possibility of these new sounds. This piece is truly the first piece of music that was ever written for a Moog synthesizer. It was written for the prototype. And I'm just gonna play a little bit about it because it's like, I call it jazz images because at that time I was very interested in jazz, obviously, and I love jazz, I still do. But at that point it was like free-form jazz. There was a lot of experimenting in what you can do with jazz. And so I thought it was kind of cool to write a piece, and I'm just gonna play you a little bit of the first part of the piece.
And rather spectacular.
That's one part of it. That's the piece is called Jazz Images, A Work Song and Blues. That was the work song portion. So this is like the little ditty that Bob wanted to hear somebody make something using his new product. So it goes back. History does go back. That was September 1964. And I want to jump a little bit back in time, because John Cage was one of the people who really said, question tonality, question what we can do, explore what we can do. But there was a French guy who moved to America and lived in Greenwich Village most of his life. His name was Edgar Varèse, and he was a pal of John Cage, especially thinking-wise. And Varèse wrote what, I want to do something here just because this has never been played. Nobody's ever heard this exactly the way you're going to hear it, which is good or bad. Varèse wrote a piece called Poème Électronique. And he wrote it for the World's Fair in Brussels in 1958. And it was the building, it was for a big electronics company, Philips. It was for Philips Electronics. And the suits were sitting around at a table, and they had the designer come in, and they had a very famous designer come in and had designed this building so that when you walk in, it is huge, and you go all around this building and see all these new pieces of electronic stuff that Philips was designing. So he said, I'm going to design this building for you, but you have to use music by Edgar Varèse. So they were sitting around, I just can imagine it, sitting around a work table with all the guys in suits. And they said, well, what does this music sound like? And they played what his music sounded like at that time. Edgar Varèse was composing one of the most famous pieces he wrote a little before that, was a piece for 17 drummers. And playing all kinds of percussion sounds and no melody, no harmony, but exploring the idea of sound. And he didn't call his work music. He said, what this is sound organized in time. Now, that became the definition of music, sound organized in time. It's exactly what John Cage said in 1937, you know, but we're going to do this a little different because I'm going to join in on the theremin. I haven't tried to tune it in, but I'm going to join in, and we're going to listen to Poème Électronique for a while. It's a little long. I'll find a nice spot to just click it off, but I'll do what I can do with it. So let's make sure that we're on the right track. No, that's certainly not. That actually, I see where I am. I didn't change. By the way, that was actually the first few seconds of a piece of mine, which was all recorded stuff, and it's on my CD, and I did intentionally steal it from Mozart, but let me catch this. Oh, I'm also changing the disc, which I forgot to do. This is Poème Électronique. The idea, by the way, when they said, we don't want to listen to this kind of music, the designer of the building said, well, that's too bad, then let somebody else design your building. He was a very famous architect. Thank you. You know, I hope you were having as much fun as I was. And then, so you're really hearing something that was never done before. I mean, you know, I mean, I've done that, but it's never been the same. You know, he wrote this in 1958. He wrote that stuff. There were no synthesizers used in that recording. Absolutely nothing. He used his own voice. You could hear there were points where you could recognize him talking, but laughing, playing, doing strange sounds, getting some sounds from oscillators, but there was no actual creation of music using a synthesizer or a keyboard or anything like that. It was all done on two big tape recorders. And the next thing that I'd like to talk about a little bit, we can't ignore it, is the basic Moog synthesizer. And I don't know how well you can see it. I can move, well, no matter how I move it, I don't have that much room. I'm not gonna play it unless somebody wants to come up and play. I absolutely have no problem with anyone wanting to come up and play, just to get up and try and play a little bit on the theremin. Do I see somebody smiling? Would anybody there like to come up and try to play the theremin? I'm welcome, especially if you've never played it. Okay, come on, you look like you've already played a theremin. That's okay. I can just tell by the smile. Because you're welcome. Okay, that's on. Now, yeah, this hand controls only the loudness, and this hand controls the pitch. Now you have to be up to get it loud enough. Okay, let's see if they...
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. All right. Now, back in about the 1980, I got involved in composing in a style called minimalism, which and that whole minimalist world has, you know, in many ways has taken over. I think I'll leave you off for a while. When you turn it off, it screams. Quietly. I said, don't turn me off. and here's a little minimalist piece. I'll just doodle a little bit on it. Should be on. Let's see if we're on. Thank you. Let's just play one more piece. This is a piece that I wrote in 1973. At that time, I actually had a band for a couple of years called The New Kitchen Sink. And of course, S-Y-N-C was the way to spell sink. And so I had the New Kitchen Sink, and I did play for a couple of years, and then I said, teaching is great, I love teaching, I love being in school. And this is a tune I wrote for the New Kitchen Sink. The interesting thing about this, anybody who knows it, one of the things I do when I teach music is, right at the beginning of a session, I always ask some, you know, usually pretty girl, but anybody can answer it, for their phone number. and then the phone number becomes in the key of C. Thinking in the key of C, if you know the piano, the number C, D, E, F, G, A, B, C. I make C, the low C, either a zero or a one. This one girl gave me a phone number. It was 6814149. So that became the sixth step on C scale. Those are the notes. I said, well, I wrote this tune in 1973, so I don't really remember the girl very well, and I call the piece Forgot Your Number. but let's see how our sound is today. Are we okay with, are we okay with maximum sound? Okay, I don't hear anything, so I'm just pushing it up a little bit. Don't turn it up, please. Okay, okay. Without a monitor, I know that these speakers are great, so except that I'm here and they're out there. Okay, that's fine. Okay. Lost your number. Let's see where we are.
Thank you.
thank you all very much. I did bring a few copies of the CD that I made, which is called From Moog to Mac, which was the name that this whole session was given. It's got, you know, some of the music you heard today, but not a lot, not all of it. In fact, not most of it. And I'd be very happy to talk to anyone like around the back, and if they have questions and things you would like to ask me, I'll be around the back.
Herb, that was quite a treat, and I think.